It's so easy. When you begin to let God be God, when you begin to enjoy His presence, I don't think if you're not able to enjoy His presence, if you're distracted by all the things that would cause you all the grief and concern and worry. I see so many people looking so sorrowful when they say, Holy Spirit, I yield myself to you. It's like, you know, they're trying to repent at the same time they're telling God they're going to obey. And their face looks strained. I think that when you start saying that properly, you have a big old smile on your face. Holy Ghost, I yield myself to you. Hallelujah. What an opportunity. I mean, that's like, you know what? That's like buckle up, you know. It's like the exciting ride that's somewhat threatening and scary, but also lots of fun. And I don't know, man. I have a different salvation than most people do. I have a different relationship with God than most people do. I've got one that I'm very, very excited about it. I'm excited about it in church and outside of church. Hallelujah. I've got one that's filled me with joy unspeakable and full of glory. I've got one that filled me with peace that passes understanding. Hallelujah. I got one I could have in prison, just like I could have right now. Hallelujah. I've got an undisturbed peace. I've got a faith that doesn't depend on anything or anyone except for Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I've got a relationship with the Holy Ghost that supplies all that I have need of all day long. That's why I quit the sin business. I left the sin business a long time ago. The things that belong to the lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, and the pride of life. Lift your hands towards heaven right now. Lift your hands up towards heaven. Lift your hands towards heaven right now. Let the Holy Ghost come on you right now. And there's several other people in your condition right now. Touched right now. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Casta pena siti kiamosa. Amen. Hallelujah. God has a lot for you right now. He wants to touch you right now. Listen, if you can't control her, you're going to have to take her out. Sipakuru mosipe atashira. Este peronopatila. Ikiranamunzesesi. Este peronakasipratifi. Librebu sikina masepratust. Papa's here. Holy Ghost is here. Power of God's here right now. Touch you. Whatever you want, you can have it. All you have to do is just believe God that He's God right now. That He's here, that He's right now, that He's present, that He'll do the things that He said that He would do. You don't have, if you have to strain over it, nothing's going to happen. But if you can just receive the reality of it in your spirit. Father, we'll touch you, heal you. Hallelujah. He'll fill you up with everything good. You know, the Lord wants you to walk around in a glory 24 hours a day. It's an undisturbed peace glory. It's an overflow of His love and His joy. Hallelujah. Prasudi mingili pro pasaya. Now there's a fire in our bellies, and so there's a tension on patience because there's so much to do. You know, but you get so set on the pursuit of the things of the kingdom, people don't understand why you don't have time for the trivial nonsense that has no meaning or value. You know, people want to just lock you down. You want to lock your own self down, drag yourself over into some kind of a counseling session that you would give yourself as you psychoanalyze it. Huh? And try to figure it all out. Father, why don't you just submit to the Word, obey the Word, let God's Word be exalted above everything. He's exalted His Word above everything. He's exalted His Word above His own name. Hallelujah. And if you just begin to do that, you just begin to take the instruction of God. You know, the Holy Spirit doesn't sit down and walk you through all of your issues, you know, and try to convince you that what He would like for you to do is the best thing for you. He just simply says, does it, do it, and leaves it there. If you do it, then great, you're going to be blessed. If you don't do it, then you're not going to be blessed. You know, Father has done so much for us in His goodness. And, you know, I pray that you would take up the privilege and the opportunity of learning to let the Spirit of the living God flow through you and be made manifest through your life. You come to understand that prayer is all about giving yourself to the Holy Spirit so He can begin to express His glory through your life. And the more you give yourself to that expression of His glory through your life, the stronger His manifest presence becomes and the stronger the expressions of His glory are through your lives. I mean, people got prayer all wrong, and I just pray that it'll be start becoming something that is praying with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. I pray that you build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And I pray that you'll pray in the Spirit, the unknown, the things that God, the Holy Ghost, utters. And then begin to pray by the Spirit and the understanding also. And that you begin to enjoy what it means to live. This is revival. This is what it means to live in the inheritance. So many people, they just, once again, we'll tell them over again. I've been telling people this for 34 years. So many people over and again, they hear and they begin forgetful hearers of the word. And I understand that's what happens when you're distracted by the cares of this life, by the deceitfulness of riches and the pleasures of this world. I understand this is the consequences. This is what happens when you allow the things that are about you, the thorns that would entangle you of the cares of this life. This is what happens when you're distracted by those things that will ultimately take you over when the kingdom of God's not first in your life, first and foremost. But tonight, I want to talk to you about this great opportunity that Father has given us. And I want you to recognize that you can't have it. You can't move in it until you do it His way. He'll love you. He'll move on you. You'll feel the moving of His Spirit. He'll use you where where you allow Him. But you'll never really truly step into all that He has for you. And I pray that if you weren't here this morning for any reason, maybe you're helping out in another meeting, you listen to this morning's message. Because you can't. People, I'm telling you right now, anybody who labors in this ministry, come on down. Anybody who labors in this ministry, they are responsible. They're responsible for the things that God is saying in here in every meeting. So if you're in the nursery or you're in children's ministry or youth ministry and you miss a meeting, you're responsible to understand what God is saying, what the Lord has laid out there. Otherwise, you're missing, whole dimensions of opportunities that the Lord has for you just because you're not being faithful to the things of the kingdom. And if you're not faithful to the things of the kingdom, if you're not faithful in little things, Father desperate to give you more, but He's not able to. Because as I was ministering this morning, how did the Lord said there are those who knew the Lord's will. They knew what to do. They knew the Lord's will. They knew what He wanted, but they did not prepare. And He says, cast them out. There's 10 virgins. They come. They all, from a humanistic point of view, from some kind of a rational point of view, they've all done so well. They made 90%. You know what? They're virgins. They're going out to meet the bridegroom. They're all bringing their lamps. But when it came down to the end, there were those who knew the will of the Lord that they were supposed to bring with them extra oil. They didn't bring. They didn't prepare. And they came, and they didn't react until it was too late. When it was too late, then they finally reacted. Then they go and they do what you think they're supposed to do. Look at them, give them a pass for trying. They went and bought oil from those who sell it, and now they're knocking on the door, and the Lord says, I tell you with absolute certainty, I have no idea who you are. And that doesn't fly with the thinking of this world and the culture and the ideas of men, but that's the way God is. There's no compromises here. All these things just simply reveal the state of the heart about Him. If we'll obey God's word, our heart will be right. If we don't obey God's word, our heart won't be right, no matter how much we say our heart is right. If we don't let the Spirit of the Lord come upon us to begin with and change our heart will never be right. God, the Holy Ghost, is here to work a miracle for you so that your heart will be right. You don't know your own heart. God knows your heart. He's the one who can make your heart right. He's the one who can prepare you so that everything about you are those things that are pleasing unto Him. And that's why He sent forth His word. His word will work mightily in you. It will work effectual in you. His word will become engrafted into your soul, into your inner being, which is able to save you. His word is a power that brings forth everything that He's purposed to be in our life. And we call it fruit, or the manifestation of His will in our life. And so, that is an important context for you to have to really be able to grasp what the Spirit of the Lord wants to say to you tonight. Because I believe that the Word of God goes forth as this very viable and super powerful seed that will, you talk about, it will come and miraculously begin to produce the fruit of God's will and supernatural working in your life if your heart is prepared to receive it. If you're willing to grab a hold of it and take it. Many people get offended over the word, and thus the word never does really truly take root. Many people are hard in their spirit and hard in their lives and hearts as the word goes forth, and Satan is able to scoop it up, and it isn't even relevant. It isn't even remembered. God wants to burn his word on the inside of you. His word is something you should be so easily united with, for you're born of the seed of the word. You're a product of the word of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Living word came and brought to us this wonderful new birth and kinsmanship with him. Hallelujah. So that in everything about what God has to say is that which we delight to do. Yes. In the volume of the book, we delight to do it. Hallelujah. It was all written about Jesus, and we enjoy every dimension of it. Open up your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 1. And I'm going to talk to you real quickly about the good pleasure of Father's will. I'll just take you through a list real quick. Are you there? Tell me when you get there, holler out. One person knows how to holler out. I hope you're not hurt sometime in the woods, man, because I'll tell you, nobody's going to find you. Ain't going to find you. Hallelujah. Hey, Tamako Yeshiradaya. Hallelujah. Tapako de Manjaresadaya. Halamande. Halamande. Halamande Rasiatonas. Halamande. Hear the word of God and receive it into your spirit. Halamande to receive a talam. The Lord will work his miracles. He'll work his signs and wonders in you. You just got to be willing to believe him. You got to get out of your offense. You got to get out of your issues. You got to see, many of the things that are holding people back are where that they're hanging on to themselves, their self-importance. They have all these things and all these ideas that they're demanding to have, whether it's recognition or whether, the list goes on. They need to examine all of it. You've got to be willing to let all that stuff go. Father's got a far better life for you to live than you. And he doesn't want to produce another you. He's got the life of Christ Jesus for you to live. And, you're going to go through a tension in growing up as to whether or not you're going to be excited about living his life. But I'm here to tell you, it's so wonderful to live the life of the Spirit. It is so wonderful to be filled with the Holy Ghost 24 hours a day. It is so wonderful to walk in the wonderful things of heaven. The Lord sits before us life and death. He says, choose. He sits before us good and evil. He says, choose life and live. He sits before us heaven and hell. There's a lot of people choosing other things. These are really pleading meetings where God is pleading with you to cease from your own way. God is pleading with you to hear the word and respond to the word and do the word. Because there are so many people that they just think, well, they're right because they sat and heard. You're not right because you sat and heard. You're right because you do. Because the hunger and the passion, when you get so hungry for God, you begin to hear the word of God and you hear it in a whole different dimension. You hear it in the dimension of it, wow, that's the answer to my question. That is the supply to my need. Now all of a sudden you become a doer of the word. It becomes implemented in your life. Amen. The grace of God is here doing this work. You can't say, well, I'm trying to, but it's not working. No. Listen to all that Father has done for us. The scripture says in verse 5 that he gave us sonship out of his own good pleasure. That's what it says right there in verse 5. He predestinated us to sonship by Jesus Christ in himself according to his own good pleasure. The own good pleasure of his will. It's what he did by his own will. Philippians says he does both will and do of his good pleasure. He both wills and does of his good pleasure on the inside of us. It's him. It's he that willeth and does. It's right in the context of work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. And the scripture says he both wills and does of his good pleasure within us. And I was ministering this morning out of Luke chapter 12. And Luke chapter 12, I believe it's verse 31. I'm pretty sure that's what it's right around in there. His father says, it's my good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Huh? Go look at that. Go, just look at it real quickly. Does anybody else smell those verses of Scripture? Or has anybody else got those verses of Scripture burning in their spirit over here? Huh? Anybody? Is it 31 or is it 35?
32.
Huh? 32. It's 32. Praise God. Hallelujah. Can you stare at that for a minute? Just stare at that. Now while you're straining and trying so hard to talk God in to all the things that He's purposed to do through your life, like somehow He's slacking and here you are working really hard and here you are just cooperating fully and here you are doing everything you know how to do and it just ain't working out like God's coming up short, right? No. He brought you into this. He's trying to get you positioned so you can receive what it is He's doing according to His own good pleasure, the own good pleasure of His will. He didn't only give you that. Verse 5, Ephesians chapter 1, He didn't only give you sonship in Christ Jesus. According to his own good will, He also caused you to understand the mystery of His will according to His own good pleasure. These are the things Father is pouring out. He's pouring out abundant. There's an abundant supply of these things. Somehow we've been distracted with other things. Somehow we've got over into doubt. Somehow we've got over into the complaint. Somehow we become imprisoned by all kinds of different types of things, even like religion. All these things that really basically they belong to self. We've been imprisoned by them. We don't know how to stand still and enjoy His presence. People think it's awkward. All of a sudden we just get quiet. I won't come out, I'm not gonna be quiet long. You just get a little quiet before the Lord. But if you're just quiet sitting here thinking about some terrible, problem you have or some terrible failure or some terrible consequences or predicting some terrible event to happen, I'm going to tell you it's going to get bad. It's going to get worse. You're not going to enjoy the presence of God. You're not going to have an outworking rather than the presence of God that comes from enjoying His presence. But as you just begin to yield to Him, what does that mean to yield to Him? I mean, if you think about it, do you really understand what it means to yield to Him? What do you do? What do you do? Yield to God. What do you do? Lay down on the floor and roll your eyes in the back of your head. What do you do? Yield to God. You submit yourself to His word. You believe His word. You start believing what He said about you. You start believing that He's present. You begin to let God be God. You start recognizing that Christ Jesus is in you. Holy Ghost fills you. There's rivers flowing out of you. That He's blessed you with every good thing. And I'm telling you, this, dear people, if you walk around and need the approval of men, you've got a problem. Your salvation hooked up with man, not just direct to God. And then, because there's so many people that are stuck under that fearful thing, that intimidating thing that works in the realm of human pride, self-reliance. Listen, man, you just get over here and enjoy the presence of the Lord. You got His approval. You got all the approval you need. People always trying to find from other human beings, either their spouse, husband's trying to find from the wife trying to find from the husband, all different kinds of children trying to find from the father. Father's trying to find from other things. All these various different needs, things that would satisfy needs that can only be met by God Himself. You need some of you just don't feel like you're getting enough approval and getting enough pats on the back and enough recognition and acknowledgement. You need to go to Jesus. Amen. You need to get yourself an encounter with God. You won't have that problem no more.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I don't know one pioneering preacher, one revivalist that ever had anybody giving him approval. Don't know of one, not in history. Not one. And nobody was saying, hey, that's great. In fact, they were doing just the opposite. Won't you shut up? Won't you stop? Won't you quit? Hey, I tell you, it's a different kind of people. It's the people who know their God that are going to have breakthroughs in their life. It's the people who begin to recognize, begin to interact with Father. Oh, know that He is abundantly supplied. He's abundantly supplied everything that we need. I mean, where we can just go, oh, God, I recognize that You supplied everything that I have need of, and I just thank You so much for it. You know, go, oh, Lord, I know You supplied everything that I have need of, and I don't know what's wrong with me, why I can't have any of it. You see, you started off good, you ended bad. You started off in faith and immediately went over to doubt. You started off in praise and went into accusation. Uh-oh. You need to be taught of God. You need to be taught of the Word. You need to start speaking the Word. You need to start believing the Word of God. Needs to fill your mouth. Needs to fill your spirit. The Lord says, pray always with awe.
praying always with all. Did you ever hear that? Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. I know what the bride, yes, she is. Somebody said, I can't do that. Well, you might not be able to do that, but if you'd yield to the Holy Ghost, he'll do it through you. Yeah, and be a different kind of life, and then you will be different in the church. You just haven't done it yet. When are you going to start doing it? People nod their heads at me all the time, and they haven't started doing it. I don't understand that. It'd be better not to nod your head if you're not doing it. You know what I'm saying? Just go, I need to do that. Other than nodding your head, because then I think that you're agreeing that you think you're already doing that, and you're not doing that. Because if you were doing it, there would be a manifestation outworking God's power, because I understand what takes place there, because I participate with that first and foremost. I understand the outworking of that in the Word. Then I understand the outworking of that by experience. You grow and mature in the expressions of God and the yieldingness to all that He is supplying, to where that there is a glorious manifestation of all that Father has, that He's richly supplied to us in Christ Jesus. This wonderful outworking of His love, of his exuberating love, of His glorious, unspeakable joy and unspeakable gift and peace that passes understanding and all these things. And then on top of that, the working of His mighty power, the faith, the activity of praise and the dimension of thanksgiving that erupts from the soul, so prepared by God. All you got to do is say, I'm going to start participating. Papa's given it to me. How did He give it to me? Begrudgingly? No, out of His own good pleasure, out of the generosity of His desire. This is what He wills. This is what He wants. This is His idea. He's watching over His Word to bring it to pass in our life. He's looking for somebody who would stop making excuses and stop redefining the Word and just start agreeing with them and living it. I said over this over and over again, start at Matthew chapter 1 and verse 1 and just start reading it and obey. Just do it. Your life will be changed. Don't just read to just sit there and read so that you have Bible knowledge. Read it and then get up and go and do it. Read it and then consecrate your life and say, Father, I'm going to do this. Hello. Listen to me. Just want to make sure everybody's awake. You need this. Hallelujah. Because there's a lot of people who know the will of the Lord, but they don't prepare themselves, and He's going to say, out. They know the will of the Lord. He said it. I read it to you this morning. The Lord says that over and over again. In fact, He said it right there in the same chapter that He said it's His good pleasure to give to us the kingdom. It's His good pleasure. It's ours. It's right now. We can have it. His kingdom, His righteousness. We can enjoy it. People look at it as though it's something hard to achieve, something that, you know, they've got to get some special insight to lay hold on. No, according to His own good pleasure, He made known to us the mystery so we can fully understand exactly how to participate with Him, so that we can walk in the inheritance that hallelujah. I praise God that, I mean, I've got one person here. I've got Leslie just receiving and just excited about it. I've got a couple of other people with a smile on their face. But the majority of the people are looking like that, you know, you in double jeopardy. You know, people say, I can't believe the look He gave me. I can't believe the look you gave me. I'm not back to it. I can't believe the look you gave God. We just want you to begin to just tonight, we want you to just understand the joy of His salvation. We want you to understand the goodness of His heart and the goodness of His will. We want you to understand how excited about you He is. He's so excited about you. You're so important to Him. He sacrificed His only begotten Son for you. That's hard for people to get. And for me, I believe that one thing that opens the key to yieldedness, one of the great keys to yieldedness that causes you to open up your heart and begin, I hope you're enjoying that, begin to receive from the Lord is to begin to know and believe the love that God has for us. This is simple. It's a simple key. There is a lot of people, they've got all these things going on in their life and they run ruin. They run interference. They've either had a mean dad or a mean brother or a mean boss or a mean somebody. And then all of a sudden everybody's mean to them. The only person that loves them and understands them, their dog.
And that dog does not really love you like that and does not understand you. That's just the way God created him or her. But it's just he wrote it to that level. And you can easily get past it if you can just begin to just accept what he did. If you can just step into the joy of salvation. I think so many people do not really come into salvation. They hear the good news. They respond. And they stand right outside the gate. And they don't even really agonize to go in. They just walk around the gate and say, hey, it's beautiful standing outside the gate. This is the gate called Christianity. This is the gate called Jesus saves. This is the gate called Jesus died for me. This is the gate called Jesus rose again. This is the gate called he ascended up on high. This is the gate called where you baptized in the Holy Ghost. This is the gate called where the rivers of living water flow out of you. But they never go in. Go in. Come in, please. Would you stop? Get in here.
You're not doing yourself any good out there. You're not doing anyone else any good out there. Because they can all see it's not as important to you as you're trying to make believe it is. Otherwise, you'd be on the inside. It's not hard to receive all that Father has. It's just found, just wrapped up in love. Just wrapped up in knowing and believing the love that God has for you. It all of a sudden, your heart just opens up before. And that's enough to get excited about for all eternity. That's enough to start dancing around about. For all eternity. It's so built up on the inside of me. I mean, I love singing songs like it's a fire on the inside of this word. It's like a fire burning in me. Because it is. It's no make-believe for me. That's real. I love singing about Father being a consuming fire because he is, and it's awesome, and it's wonderful. Yes. Hallelujah.
There's so many things to be excited about God in. You know, so many things, names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. He's come live on the inside of us. Hallelujah. He's given us everything that we need that pertains to life and godliness. I mean, all these things that he's done out of the good pleasure, out of his own good pleasure. Hallelujah. Look at this other verse of Scripture. It's a powerful verse of Scripture. Anybody who knows what Scripture I'm going to go to now? Because I've quoted now every good pleasure of Scripture in the New Testament. I've quoted every good pleasure. I've quoted every good pleasure scripture in the New Testament. There's only one good pleasure scripture left. And then just pray, you know, you just begin to just absorb the word of God. Evidently, some of you just been looking at all the bad scriptures. And you've been meditating on the bad things. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. I mean, you know, and you're wondering, am I a worker of iniquity? Do I even know God? Does he love me? I mean, you get over in the good things and understand all the good pleasure of his will. There's one other verse of Scripture. No, it's 2 Thessalonians. Don't want you to work too hard. It's chapter 1, verse 11. You heard me quote it many times, a very important verse of Scripture to me. It's something that God does out of the good pleasure of his goodness. Woo! There's something God, Father, he counts us worthy to fulfill all the good pleasure of his goodness. The good pleasure to give us the kingdom. The good pleasure of sonship. The good pleasure of knowing the mystery of his will. I didn't get to the other one. But the good pleasure or the pleasure of the inheritance that we now have in him that he gave and supplied to us. It was his pleasure to do it. I believe it's verse 11 of Ephesians chapter 1. But now here he is, that he would count us worthy and fulfill all the good pleasure of his goodness. Woo! That's a whole lot right there. Just, my God, say pretty. I didn't even get to the work of faith with power yet. I'm still stuck over here on the good pleasure of his goodness. They would count me worthy. What does that mean? I understand where people were not counted worthy because they set their hand to the plow and they turned back. I can go out, I can quote one thing after the next to you, the things that Jesus said over and again that has taught me lessons, that has helped me to understand what to do and what not to do, what pleases him and what causes his heart to ache, what he says is blessed and what he says well done to, and those things which he says, I'll have nothing to do with you, I do not know you, you're not worthy of the kingdom, in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. I don't have to guess at this. I'm so
concerned and busy and set on to pleasing Papa, I don't have time for anybody else. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Hello. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Quit trying to please everybody. Start pleasing the one who it counts with. Hallelujah. Because I'll tell you right now, he'll make it to where that nothing else matters. Hallelujah. All that matters is that you show people his love and his glory after having sinned in his love for a while, being overwhelmed by his love for you. I want you to be able to understand that there are so many people who are brokenhearted. There are so many people who are in prison. There are so many people that are under the snare of the enemy. There's no one that's come into their life with an anointing to break off that yoke so that they could be released from the snare of the enemy and the powers of darkness and begin to have the spirit of wisdom and revelation, the good pleasure of God unfolding the mystery of his will, open up to them, and there they begin to encounter his love. And I guarantee you what's going to happen is they're going to bust and they're going to break and they're going to weep and they're going to cry and their whole life is going to be changed. But you got to first be a partaker of it. Father's purpose to raise up deliverers. Did you know that?
Yes.
The scripture says, and I know that it's talking a lot about, I know that in many respects it's talking about the millennial reign in Obadiah chapter 1 verse 21, that he should raise up deliverers, literally saviors, which is the same as deliverers, messiahs. You can actually loosely translate it that way, upon Mount Zion, and they shall judge the Mount of Esau. But God raised up deliverers because he raised up Jesus. And he raised up Jesus. And when he raised up Jesus, he raised up Jesus for the purpose of raising us up together in him, to anoint us together with him, to go do his same ministry. Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. I've been anointed of the Holy Ghost to go and proclaim the good news to the poor, to the people who are needy. They're desperate for change. They want something. They need help. I need help. I'm naked. I need clothing. I'm desperately hungry. I'm thirsty. I need food and drink. That's the poor in spirit. To bind up the broken heart who's been abused and whose lives have been trashed and run over time and time again by the wickedness that is in men, because they're taught, they're born in sin, and every day of their life shaped in iniquity. I don't care. The best person on the planet that doesn't know the Lord Jesus Christ on the inside of them, they are so imprisoned by the will of the satanic realm. Because they shaped in iniquity. Father wants us to be born in righteousness and shaped in purity. To be every day shaped by the Holy Spirit. Instead of shaped by demon spirits. He wants us to rise up in this wonderful anointing and begin to understand the beauty of what it means to live in this freedom and this love and enjoy all the good things of heaven. Walk around all day with praise in our mouth, with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Walking around continually building up ourselves, walking around enjoying the heavenly, choosing the life rather than the death, choosing the good rather than the evil, choosing heaven rather than hell. People say, well, I can't believe a loving God would send me to hell. It's your choices. People live in hell right now. They chose to live in hell. God's pleading with them. Come over here. Don't live in that thing. And yet they won't walk in the right way. And then you can see it in a very crude way, in a very, you know, very extravagant way. Maybe I could say it that way. When people are running to the bars and living in adultery and living in fornication, living all kinds of wickedness, witchcraft, where they're not obeying the word. And thus, there's the consequences of the curse and the demonic stronghold in the life. But many people can't see it now where it becomes more subtle. Father has things that you've got to receive. Well, he wants you to receive tonight, but your heart's got to be right to receive them. All these things that he abundantly supplies, it's for you, it's yours. But you're going to have to be willing to cooperate with him and let him have his will and way in your life so that he may be counted worthy. Paul's saying, he's praying, desirous, hoping, looking to God that he would count you worthy. He didn't say that he can't count us worthy. He was already there. He would count you worthy. God had already been fulfilling the good pleasure of his goodness in him. Now he's talking to them. When he was talking about the resurrection, we shall all be changed.
He's in that. Now he's not. He's already got what he's inviting the rest of the church to have. That God will fulfill the good pleasure of his goodness on the inside of you with the work of faith, with the work of faith and power.
Yes.
Huh? And you can actually translate that with the work, with the divine working of God's power, faith. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You step into that and you're going to quit worrying about your job and your paycheck because you got faith enough to get coin out of the fish's mouth. Yes. You got faith enough to call in the finances. You got faith enough to step into the riches that God has laid up for the righteous in the house of the wicked.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You got faith to call things in, to speak things as though they that are not as though they were. It becomes a whole new dimension. You're not worried about your clothes. My goodness, you're so captivated with the one who owns it all. Hallelujah. Yeah. Somebody said to me the other day, they were quoting the scripture, the Lord owns cattle on a thousand hills. I said, that's right, and he owns it all too. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Not just a thousand, every bit of it, because that's just an expression of he owns it all. You're eating his food while it's getting in the way of walking with him. Huh? You're wearing his clothes while it's getting in the way of walking with him. You're living under a divine peace that he himself mandated the United States of America while you're being distracted from walking with him. Are you listening to me? You're spending his money while you're being distracted by it and keeping you from walking with him. Huh? You could have easily been born in a nation that has nothing. You could have easily been born in a culture that would not allow you to be anything other than a slave. There's so many things to be thankful for, dear people. There's so many things for us to begin to enjoy with response to Father. You've given it all, and I thank you for it, but you're more important to me than it all. The Lord wants to look at you, and he wants to say, I am your exceeding great reward.
Amen.
Hello. Yeah. Hello. Don't worry about anything. I am everything that you have need of. I am El Shaddai. I am the Almighty. And I am for you. I am exceeding reward. You know, it's like Allie was telling me about the girls. You know, both of them had catastrophes yesterday. One face planted into an electrical socket. One wearing her Mimi's dress for the first time, which was goes down to her feet, tripped over it, and face planted going down the stairs, but they were all fine. Divine protection. Just living in protection. Anybody else's kids would be in a hospital with a broken neck, busted, broken nose, whatever. You know what I'm saying to you? Stitches. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
There's a place where we can live in the glory, dear people. There's a place where Father wants to bring us to a place where we get to know him even in a greater way, where we just continually go from glory to glory, from one encounter to the next encounter. I mean, when we think, I think about Isaiah. I love reading Isaiah chapter 1 through 5. Because Isaiah is so passionate. He's so radical. He's so getting after it on behalf of God. I want to be like Isaiah. He was such a radical preacher, man. He laid it down. He laid it down like Father speaks it, People don't realize this. They think out of their own preferences and ideas because their model is some motivational preacher, that the people who lay it down like God speaks it's wrong. But the problem is you've got the wrong model that you're judging by. You listen to me. Somebody said, my daddy hollered at me when I was a kid and scared me to death. And when you start laying it down like that, I just think of my dad and I get all scared. You need to be delivered.
Yes.
You need to be delivered. That's not something to go judging whether the preacher's right or wrong. Hello, you need to stop all that nonsense because it's going to keep you from the good stuff. You need to stop all that nonsense because it's going to keep you from the sense. Hallelujah. You need to stop all that mess. I mean, tell you right now. Start living by the Word of God. Start just enjoying the presence of God. Let everything that Father is speaking, let all of His words be your delight. Hallelujah. Be what you feast off of. Be how you think, how you make decisions. And now, there you're going to begin to eat the good things and be full. And you're going to begin to eat the good things and be satisfied. Hallelujah. Well, I know what the Father's good pleasure is. Father's good pleasure that you live in the fullness of God.
Yes. Amen.
One amen, one hallelujah, one little bit of grunt, one half smile, five
I can't believe that he just said that. 40 shocked faces. And when I say those things, when I begin to declare God's word, it is potent enough. It's living.
Amen.
It's powerful.
Amen.
It's spirit and life. If you are ready to receive, it will explode on the inside of you. Your hands will go up in the air, and you'll feel like you just got hit by a lightning bolt. I'm not kidding you. I've watched it happen. It's happened to me. It's just like the entrance of his word makes you alive. He quickens you according to his word. Hello, you talk about a quickening. Woo! Hallelujah. And then you want to be able to do that. You don't want to sit around going, I'm such a bad person. The pastor doesn't like me. I know he doesn't. That's what some people think. Oh, every time they go to meeting, he doesn't like me. I love you. And what does it matter really anyways? It should be hard to see and hard to even think about because you're all consumed with the all-consuming love of Almighty God. Hallelujah. You don't even notice whether people love you or not. It don't even matter no more. Woo! You're having a good time because you're enjoying the supply that comes out of it. There's a river that flows from the throne of God, a river of divine provision, a river of goodness, a river of divine glory, a river of all that we have need of, that all that pertains to life and godliness, of everything that we need for our health and everything we need for our finances, of all kinds of prosperity spiritually and materially. There's no reason for us to be poor. I believe that various degrees of religion are strongholds of various degrees of poverty. Go to the places where they're most religious, like in Alexandria, Egypt. It's poor, shamefully poor. The day that I got arrested in Alexandria, Egypt, what I was actually doing was I took the camera out because I wanted to show my friends back home the religious state. Preachers, the religious state of Egypt. So I was filming how the church was in the absolute abject poverty community, and I was filming the pollution stream, you know, the pee ditch that went right by the church. It was just horrific. And I couldn't even believe it. There's great, rich, prosperous areas in Alexandria, Egypt, but where's the church, and what do the church people look like? You know, in the most abject poverty, just living under such oppression because it's stinking religion. That's when they came and got me. It's just the powers of darkness, just trying to exercise their power against me. They didn't win. Hallelujah. Praise God. Some of my Egyptian friends didn't believe that I could ever come back from where I went. From whence they took me out into the middle of the desert in one of their military compounds. Hallelujah. I came out and here today, praise the Lord, just talk to you tonight about about the rivers of his pleasure that he wants you to drink of. People come to church, the rivers of your pleasure, woo! They leave the church screaming and hollering at one another. All upset about their living conditions. Can't believe that they didn't get a raise to the job. What's wrong with this and what's wrong with that? It's hypocrisy. God hates it. It's hypocrisy. Being two different people. Papa wants you to be the same person in church as you are out of church. Same person out of church as you are in church. He don't want you looking good for him. Looking good for the assembly. That's what he says it over and again. Listen to him talk to the Pharisees. He lays it. Matthew chapter 23, he's bringing it down. He's letting them know. He says that again. I think he says it 6 times. Hypocrites. He goes after it. Over and again. He just lays it out there. There's no need for us to have such a lifestyle when God wants to come and overwhelm us with his goodness.
when he's done all this stuff according to his own good pleasure. We stepped into sonship not because we were so right, but because he was, because on a good pleasure. We stepped into the understanding of all the mystery of his will, not because we're so insightful, but because it was good pleasure to make it known. He's here to make known, unfold all the things that belong to the realms of his divine power and glory for anybody who's willing to listen. That's what the Holy Spirit came to do.
Yes.
He came to take everything that belongs to the Father and show it to us. Mm-hmm. Everything that belongs to Jesus, reveal it to us, show it to us, make it known. Take every mystery, every hidden thing that belongs to God, that which eyes not seen, that which ears not heard, that which never yet entered in the hearts of men. He's made it ready. He's to reveal it to us by his Spirit. Somebody said, okay, when? Prayer time.
Yeah.
Prayer time. Ruh-roh. We don't have time for prayer time because it's kind of boring. And I'm all worn out. No. You don't have the wrong kind. You got the wrong kind of prayer time. You need to come over to my prayer time. My prayer time, the atmosphere changes. My prayer time, the praise, this space is filled with his glory. Ha! Huh. That is the day. And I get to stay there as long as I want. Woo! Just enjoying. I just enjoy his presence. I'm not agonizing. I'm not crying and screaming. You know, are you listening to me? I'm rejoicing and giving thanks.
Amen.
Sometimes the Lord will hit me. Sometimes the Holy Ghost will hit me with a burden for certain situations and for certain people and begin to bring out different expressions. But it all comes out of this state of joy and rejoicing. It doesn't come out of some depressed, half-depressed, melancholy state that literally is an oppressive demon spirit still at work in people's life. They've not gotten completely free. Because they've not known how to yield themselves to the Word of God and to the Spirit of God and cast down imaginations and cast down emotions that are not right. You listen to me. People have sickness and disease because they did not know how to stand up against affliction that Satan wanted to impose upon them. Satan is a rebellious imp. He's a tyrant that wants to kill you. And he'll come and lay things on you that he has no right to do. And if you do not know how to stand up on the Word of God, and you don't know how to stand up on the authority of the Spirit, you're going to be run right over top of it by him, because he is a mean machine that wants to plow everybody down, who wants to trample over all of God's Word, all of God's promises. It's just who he is. If you just step into the good pleasure of his will and recognize that God's given you the insight to recognize this and understand these things, then you are able to stand up and say, you just get on out of here. You foul spirit of hell. Because Father has given us this reign of divine power and glory. He said, I want you to go preach the gospel. Jesus said, I've been anointed by the Holy Ghost, and now you're anointed by the Holy Ghost. Go preach the gospel. Cast out devils. But if people are under the influence of demon spirits, you're not going to have any power over unclean spirits to cast them out. Many people try to communicate with unclean spirits and try to tell them the advantages of creation over evolution. Just communicating with an unclean spirit. Communicate with an unclean spirit, trying to talk to their mind. Trying to talk to the mind of the human being. Don't understand how to break the power and the authority of mind-blinding spirits. It's time you wake up. Time you wake up, recognize the Father wants to make you, he's made you in him and with the same kind of ministry that Jesus has, as one who is a deliverer, as one who comes with the word of life. The Lord Jesus said, of course, just before he said that in Mark chapter 6 in verses 12 and 13, he said in verse 11, they that receive you receive me, they that reject you reject me. That's a lot of people's problems. Because people are under the influence of personal opinions and preferences that have really been shaped and molded by demon spirits, spirits of strife. People have spirits of strife in their house. They allow it. People allow spirit of strife go on between a husband and wife. Man, they've never come into recognizing or discerning spirits or understanding even the slightest dimension of the will of his mystery to recognize that when they get into an argument with their wife, they're back and forth in a spirit of strife. It's a demon power. And they have humanized it. They've made it common. They've made it ordinary. Well, we just haven't. We not, you know. And then if you say quit arguing, well, we're not arguing. What are you doing? you've gone insane. You don't even know what you're doing anymore. I tell you for sure, you're arguing. back and forth, and it's a spirit of strife. And they want to make it as though it was a debate about who's taking out the garbage. It's a stinking spirit of strife, men. Or who was right about the instructions that they heard day before yesterday. It is amazing to me how many people have, in their own imagination, have a photographic memory. They remember exactly what was said. They don't remember that they made 60s and 70s on, 60% and 70% on most all their tests. But now all of a sudden they got a photographic memory and they remember exactly what was said last year or 10 years ago. And that is a bunch of crazy men. And it's just a spirit of strife. It's a demon spirit. It's a deceiving demon spirit. You listening to me?
Yes.
Father wants to give us insight on how to shut this stuff down, so that we can now be effective against unclean spirits to cast them out. If we're yielding to unclean spirits, we have literally abdicated our authority. We have no ability. God loves us. His mercy is there. He's still got the same call. The rivers of his pleasure is there flowing to us. His good pleasure of his will is there provided for us. All that he wants us to have, all that he wants us to experience, it's available, but we're not willing to simply obey his word and start living by the Spirit, living by that ability that he's given to us to live by. It takes people most of their life to grow up, it seems. Or even to begin to mature. It's time that you set some goals for yourself and you say, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm not going to spend the rest of my life, growing 1 year in God. Come on. Not when you can grow, as it were, a year a minute. Just let me give a scale. Huh. I'd say even a year a second. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
By the Spirit, by the time you die, you could be like 3,000, 4,000, 10,000 years old in the Spirit. Hallelujah. I mean, just maturing in God. And that's still just getting started. Instead of being derailed, broke down in a ditch, still struggling to have it your way. No, man, God wants us just to come and give ourselves over to his will. When we begin to say, Lord, I'm living to do your will, you just said you're not doing your own will anymore. Once again, we got ourselves a challenge, don't we? Yeah, because your will is constantly being expressed, and God's will is constantly being expressed in his word, but you don't remember it. You know what I'm saying to you? And that's why we need to read every day.
Amen.
Huh? There's a lot of people telling me about how that they're constantly failing, how they're constantly being overcome, how they're constantly forgetting. It's because they're constantly not in the Word. They need to get in the Word of God. They say, well, they don't have time. You don't have time to live right. You don't have time to yield to the Holy Ghost. You don't have time to be trained of God. You don't have time to be built up in the faith. You don't have time to be blessed. You don't have time to receive all the provision of heaven. You don't have time for all these good things to be fulfilled in your life. The Father has willed according to his own good pleasure.
Yep.
Not me, man. I tell you right now, I want heaven.
Yeah.
Woo.
Yeah.
I don't want just heaven when I die. I want heaven right now.
Yeah.
When you die, when you die, where will you go? You will go where you've been living. You've been living in heaven, you've been living in hell. I'm living in heaven. Hallelujah. Bakura Shinga Lapa Serenaya Halashuka Prataya. Hallelujah. I mean, just the beauty and the splendor of the revelation that Father has given us an opportunity to go into a different dimension with him just by encounters with him. I mean, he's got the great champion Job, but yet he's got another encounter for Job so that Job can go into a whole other dimension of blessing. He's got a great anointing that he's already poured out and divine ability that he's given to Isaiah, but there's an encounter for Isaiah, and that when he stands there, he can receive a provision to have now a greater ministry, a greater impact. Oh, it's so good to go to prayer.
Amen.
I got one amen, a couple of and that's really what's going on. That should have been a thunderous amen. I mean, it should have been, whoa, you're right. This is amazing. I'm so glad you pressured us into it. Hallelujah. Father does wrestle with us. He does. He's Father, for Father wrestles with the man. He said, I will not always wrestle with the man, beg him, plead with him, for he is but flesh. The number of his years shall only be yet 120 more. He puts a time. That was the day that God decided when Adam would die. Not how long it was going to take to build the ark. It was the day that God decided how long Adam would live. He appointed unto him that his death that day. It's pretty radical how, when you think about it, that Adam knew exactly how many years he had left. He could number his days. And we don't know that Adam ever did anything with it. He probably, I don't know why. It's just all assumption to try to figure out why he's not numbered in the company of the righteous. Because the righteous begin with his son Abel. When God reckons with the records of the righteous in his book, he begins with Abel. So sad. There's so many people who live their lives so short of all God's blessings today only because they want to do it their own way. Stop it. Begin to imagine yourself living out the fullness of God's word. Today, begin to imagine yourself living out the fullness of God's word. Somebody said, I try to challenge people, write a 30-year plan. They look at me like, and they go, well, I just want to do what God wants me to do. Yeah, right. Write your 30-year plan. Well, start imagining, actually living out what God said he wants you to be in his word and see what that looks like. Yes. And that's your 30-year plan right there. Hallelujah. And then begin to lay it out in a very practical sense, how that you're going to be able to do that, how you're going to be able to go there. Let the things within the Word of God create these holy imaginations where you begin to think about how you do these works and greater works than these, how God begins to use you to reach nations, how God begins to use you to impact various different segments of society. In the places of need. Understand, Father's called every one of us to take care of the orphans and the widows. God's called every one of us to support the ministry and to support the church and to support the poor. It's got to be in the framework of your 30-year plan. And then that gives you the big picture kind of your life. And then you write your 10-year plan based upon that, because that's showing you how you're going to get to your 30-year plan. Then you write your 5-year plan based upon that, because it's a goal that you got to do in a more short period of time in order to be able to make that 30-year date, that 10-year date. And then you write your 2-year plan, your 2-to-3-year plan, because now you got to start doing something tomorrow to achieve that. Amen. Yes. Hallelujah. Instead of just always, I want to do God's will. And you go and you work as a slave bent over a desk. I want to do God's will. And all you find yourself is chained to the will of man. Chained to a mortgage, chained to too many credit cards maxed out, chained, and you don't know how to get out. Because none of that ever was done in faith anyways. So you don't know how to get out of it by faith, because you got chained to it. Oh, dear people, I hope you can hear me tonight.
Yes.
I hope you just listen and respond to the Spirit of the Lord. Father wants to do great things with their lives.
Amen.
His call for us is to go everywhere and preach the gospel. He said, these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they'll cast out devils. The authority that we have right now to be able to go set people free who live in such torment. If we weren't so in our head, if we weren't so caught up in our own issues, in our own emotional struggle, in our own spiritual compromises, we would begin to walk in a great discernment and insight for the people that are around us. And with that discernment, insight, would come a great Holy Ghost compassion. Now people wouldn't be leading you into their sin. You'd be leading them into your heaven. They wouldn't be leading you into their devil. You'd be leading them into your God. I watch over again. I watch people. They have somehow been so deceived and so infiltrated with lies. They have no ability to lead people into God. They just abdicate, and the people around them lead them into their devil. Now you're just the opposite of deliverer. Huh? You were like a sheep going to the slaughter. Huh? You compromise with the powers of darkness with one word from hell. and it sets your path in the wrong decision. Praise God, there's still a way back. But you know what? You begin to live this way, become a pattern in your life, and all of your decisions start, or majority of your decisions start being fashioned after the same manner. There's so many people that are not in church here tonight. They're not here. Look around. They're not here. There's about, there's a little over, there's 14, right around 14 people that come to this church not here tonight. Some of them may be in the nursery. It's just so sad because other things are prioritized in their life. They don't realize the value of tonight. They don't realize the value of seeking the Lord. See, the Lord told us to seek His presence continually. Yes. Seek His presence continually. Yes. Seek His presence evermore. I mean, if you're given over to that, if you really are with all prayer and supplication always, with all prayer and supplication, and that is your life, you're not going to miss an opportunity to take it to a deeper level, to go into a deeper realm, to get hooked up with that much more of what Father would supply, which He does supply through His church more than anywhere else, because in the church, He placed these things, they resident in the church. If you can't receive in the church, you are bad off. You stuck. You know, there are many times in my life where I was faced with people, like, you see, they're just stuck. They can't, they're stuck. And then they just keep getting worse. They're more and more cut off from the supply of the Spirit. And I say, you know, you just got to go to another church. But unfortunately, because of the state of their heart, they got to the church and they became even worse. And they became fossilized within the stronghold of the demonic power. Imprisoned by it, never to escape. And it's like, Lord, what do we do? We've got to bring people to a place of repentance. We've got to help people understand the wrong choices they're making. And then that is a tough tension, you know, especially when you got love and compassion for the people as I have for you. And you know so simply how it is to just start doing it right. And you just want to break that thing down. You want to stop the thing. You do anyway, you know, you think, how can I get rid of it? How can we get this thing broken down? How can we stop it? Because that's just the heart of a deliverer. Huh? It is. It's the heart of a person who carries within their shoulders the responsibility to see people get it right in God. Yeah. And what I've just learned is I've learned it over and over again. You bring people under the authority of the Word, and if they submit under the authority of the Word, that there ultimately it's going to be broken if you can continually hit them with it and do not let up, and you keep the fire on it. You do not let up. It'd be broken. Amen. It'd be broken. There's some people that they can't tolerate it. They can't tolerate the fire. They can't tolerate the Word being delivered to them over and again, challenging the very issue of the stronghold in their life. And it's not supposed to be that way. And if we could just understand the wrong choices that we've made in the places where we have allowed the enemy to take an advantage over us, where the flow of the good pleasures of the things of God got shut off. If we could just go back, if we could retrace our steps and go back there and repent of that and say, I'm not going to have it in my life anymore, then things would get good. If we could just begin to have an environment in the culture of this knowing and believing God's love for us and just being bathed in love and recognizing that, yeah, Father wants us to be filled with all of His fullness, but that is a product of living in this love of Christ Jesus that passes knowledge. Yeah. And you're never going to live in the love with everybody else till you live in the love with Him.
Yeah,
you're never going to be free to grab everybody and just love them no matter who they are or what they've done till you just begin to receive all that He's supplying.
Yeah.
And you're not going to really grow in that. And it's not going to be developed in that if you're not going to go to prayer. Huh? It's not. That's why Jude said, build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keeping yourself in the love of God. That's where the sentence ends. Huh? It's a comma at the end of verse 20, and it rightly so. It ends with keeping yourself in the love of God. Being established there, being rooted and grounded in settled love. That's absolutely essential. And then you've got an environment now where when God begins to touch all these people who have not been impacted by religion, I think it's good in some respects that Bible's been taken, religion's been taken out of school. You know, it's just kind of like what happened with communism. Just to help you understand what I'm saying. What happened with communism? They were steeped in 5,000 years of ancestral worship and all other kinds of religious ideology. God used communism to take and wipe the plate as a man, to wipe the plate clean as a man wipeth the plate. To where that now they were all mandated to not have any more ties with all of the religion, not have any more ties with all the demon spirits that had been so rooted in their ancestral tradition. And there was a two, three generation gap where it was broken completely off of them. And now God prepared their heart to be hungry for the word. And look at the winds of revival, and look at the fire of revival that is burning in China. When we look at so many things that are going on in the United States of America, it wasn't really what Father has for us in this relationship with Him, this outpouring of the Holy Ghost, this living in divine glory. It was just stuck in religion and form without power, without God. And now it's as though the Lord is preparing the heart of a generation and preparing the heart of the people who've almost been isolated from the things of God. And yeah, the result is deep wickedness. But within that deep wickedness, the deeper the wickedness and the darker it gets, a greater need for revelation comes in the heart of man to be set free. Wait a minute, it can't be this. This isn't what life is supposed to be. It can't be this. Now imagine that Father is so earnestly watching over the harvest because He don't want them to be spoiled by religion. He's looking for a fertile environment in which to bring them in, where everybody's full of the Holy Ghost and fire. And you have to ask yourself this question: could you possibly be a part of what God is looking for the way you are now? You have to ask yourself that question. Would they come and get close to you and all of a sudden see you being compromised by demon spirits? I'm going to just tell you right now, when somebody's come out of the world, out of that deep darkness, and they found Jesus, I'm going to tell you right now, it is a clear distinction between life and death. Between God and the devil. And suddenly now you're showing them compromise. You're showing them a worse demonic realm than what they actually lived in. You have to ask yourself, do you live in an environment of the divine power of God, of the love of God, of the flowing forth of the Spirit of God? What flows out of the throne room of Father? Can you see it? Is it beautiful? It's a pure crystal river of every good thing, of His goodness, of His beauty, of His splendor, of His life. And that's exactly what's supposed to be pouring out of our lives. And with no mixture from any kind of self realm, any kind of a human realm. Because we've made Him our master. We've been trained by His word. We've been shaped by the Holy Ghost to now live in His beauty and live in all the things that belong to His nature. Because we gave ourselves over to these virtues. We want to be taught of God. We give, therefore, because we now have the divine nature. Because we've been escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Now that we have the divine nature, now that we've been born again, now that we're born of the Spirit and walking in the Spirit, we earnestly give ourselves to being taught of God. How to walk in the virtues and in the love and in the knowledge and in the kindness and in the godliness. And those lists of things that Peter brings together for us right there in just a little short list in 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 5 through 8. And there's more, all the dimensions of His nature we're being taught. Not if you're not going to prayer. Not if you're not being in the meeting. Not if you're not crying out to God. Not if you're not allowing His word, which is living and powerful, which is spirit and life, which goes within us and works effectually. It's not just intellect. It's not like your history book. It's not like your science book. It's not like your novel. This is living, powerful, God-breathed, supernatural word that is miraculous, life-changing word of God. Hallelujah. 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 It's causing me, it's working mightily within me right now to bring me into the fullness of the measure, the maturity, the ministry of Jesus, even unto a fully matured man over the next 9 years. Hallelujah. While others have just decided that their whole life goal is to lay aside the weight. and a sin. No, that was supposed something. That wasn't a life goal. That was something you were supposed to do right now, right then. It was a consecration. What is it? Are you going to let Jesus? Are you going to let Jesus be revealed? Are you going to let the Holy Ghost reveal the Word of God through you? If you're really dedicated, because that's what Father wants. The Son of God was manifested to be a deliverer, to destroy all the works of darkness, that sin, sickness, disease, every oppressive power of darkness. Papa has purposed that his Son should be revealed in you and me. Those things are connected in 1 John. Those are not isolated concepts. John said that in the context of, beloved, now are ye the sons of God. Now let me tell you about the Son of God. He was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. Hallelujah. And if we are so devoted to letting Christ Jesus, the Word, be revealed in us, should we not give ourselves to the Word? Should we not recognize the life-giving power, the faith-developing power, the Spirit of God power that is there, that just by the very reading of it and the meditation of it? People, I want you to know, there is not a single thing in my life and in the life of the people that I know that are growing in God that is more a catalyst for divine overflow and inspiration than the Word of God. I go to the Word, and there, I don't care how I feel. I can feel weak, tired, sick. Don't feel like thinking. I'm so tired. It hurts to think. And I go to the Word, and I start reading the Word. I start watching over the Word. Suddenly, the bubble up come. I get quickened. And then now my brain's supercharged with the life-giving power of God. A whole nother realm begins to open up to me. I'm now in charge. I'm now know where I'm going. I'm not just passively sitting there waiting for something to impact me and take me prisoner at its will. I'm not waiting for some wild, crazy thought to now overwhelm my imagination and bring me into bondage and subjugation to an earthly, sensual realm. And ultimately devilish one. I recognize that if the Word of God will abide in me, if I'll let the Word of Christ dwell in me, hallelujah, the things of this world, the things that the powers of darkness would throw at me in every dimension that he would try to assault me with can't come to me. Why? Because through the Word, guess what comes to me? The good pleasure of his will. The knowledge of his will. The knowledge of the mystery. There I'm filled. There I'm empowered. There I'm strengthened. There I'm giving a supernatural agreement. A supernatural agreement takes place in my spirit where I agree with God. And as I speak forth the Word, just like Jesus spoke forth the Word, Satan came at Jesus with everything he got, and Jesus stripped him of all of his power by simply quoting Deuteronomy. When people say that the Old Testament isn't good anymore, just say it worked real good for Jesus. It worked very effectively for Jesus. Hallelujah. If Deuteronomy can work like that for Jesus, what can John do for you? Hallelujah. What can quoting the book of Acts do for you? What can Matthew do for you? Come on. Hallelujah. You got to quit letting Satan throw tricks upon you. You got to quit letting him cast his lies and his imaginations upon you. Because you're either going to be filled with God's Word or you're going to be filled with a satanic word. You're going to be filled with God's Spirit or you're going to be filled with a demon spirit. You know, this morning I ministered on the worst state of all. There's a worst state of all. I ministered on three different states, actually four different states and conditions of people who know the Lord or who have known the Lord. And of course, 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 20 is the worst state of all. To have known him and then been entangled and overcome. The state of that man is worse than it was at the beginning, before he ever knew God. And dear people, if we would just begin to get captivated by him, we'd never run the ruin of that state. We'd never run the ruin of those who knew the will of the Lord but never prepared. We'd never run the ruin of those who say, Lord, Lord, did signs and wonders but never knew him. We'd never run the ruin of being foolish. Something's got to happen in our life and in our conduct where we begin to see ourselves. as those people that God purposed us to be in Christ Jesus. That God purposed us to be and modeled for us in the life of Jesus. To where no matter what your vocation is, no matter what walk of life you're in, you walk around knowing that you're a deliverer. Amen. Knowing that you have power over everything Satan's doing. Amen. You now live in another realm. You now have a clear distinction between everything that belongs to the satanic realm and everything that belongs to this world and who you are. And now you set, you on guard, you're ready to cast out devils. Hallelujah. You're ready to, you know, to lay hands on the sick and see them recovered. Of course, in the verse of scripture that I was referring to in Mark chapter 6, verse 12, they anointed them with oil, prayed over them. They were healed of their diseases and of their sicknesses. That's who we are. To live over in this place where we find ourselves caught away, doing the will of the Father, caught away, being, living out the life that Christ Jesus purposed, that Father purposed, to destroy the works of the devil. Everywhere we find, we're on a mission. We seek out and destroy.
Yes.
You're not going to be being over enticed to agree with iniquity. Jesus. You know, for me, when I walk around, I get, the Lord allows me to see things that are going on in people's lives, you know. There's nothing hidden from Father. He sees all. He knows exactly. He actually shows me pictures of what people were doing in the secret place. He does that. And He doesn't want that to be going on in your life. He doesn't want you to be so distant from Him and so absent from Him that you could live such a false life. That you would choose death. I mean, it's been a scenario of men. Even those who got to see His glory. They went and they chose death. There was no hardening them to serve God. Yeah, they dwell. It's a sad state to dwell in darkness and under the shadow of death. And God's goodness and His mercy, He caused the light to spring up. But men love evil more than they love righteousness. They love the demonic realm more than they love the realm of the Spirit. They love to run with the masses that are on the road to destruction. Huh? Because it doesn't look very fun and popular to walk upon the road that leads to life because there's just a few walking on that road. It's a narrow road. It's smooth, though. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's the highway of the King. It's beautiful. It's joy on the road. It's celebration on the road.
Amen.
They're fascinated by the highway of the wicked. Broad is the way that leads to destruction, and that's where the masses are going. You're not going to make heaven unless the life of Jesus Christ has found place in your existence. And I'm going to even make it even stronger. You're not making heaven unless you live the life of Jesus. It's more than Jesus came into my heart. It's more than Jesus dwells in me. It's Jesus living in you. It's you no longer living.
Yes.
You cannot say that you are walking with God if you've not given yourself over to live the life of Jesus, to be taught the life of Jesus. Where you wake up in the morning and it's like, all I want, Lord, is to know and understand how to live out this glorious life of Jesus. People say, I want to live out my own life. Really what you're choosing is, I want to live out a demonic life. I'm going to choose the same thing that Adam chose when he rebelled. It's because God has given every single human being the same opportunity to make the same choice that Adam made. Now your death and your consequences of your death aren't just because somebody else chose, an ancestor chose, and then by consequence it fell on you. Now God liberated you and gave you an opportunity to choose life and live. And then if you make the wrong choice, He got His mercy there and His grace there to forgive you and to pardon you over and over again, so long as you're willing to get it right. But at some point in time, we're going to have to get sold out on getting it right. Hello.
Amen.
Some point in life, we're going to have to decide to really decide, you know. We're going to have to just get planted in the house of God. I wrote a song early on it. In the early days of my ministry, when the Lord called me to pastor, I'm a young and tender olive tree. That's how I imagined myself. It's the Word of God. I'm quoting the Word of God, and I love to sing the Word of God. I'm a young and tender olive tree planted in the house of the Lord. I'm planted. I'm not going to jump up and run with my roots and go hang out with the wicked. I discovered blessed is the man who walked not in the counsel of the ungodly, stands in the way of sinners. Huh? I'm a young tender olive tree planted in the house of the Lord. What do you imagine yourself to be? What do you see yourself to be? Because when you've got an imagination going on, you've got something that you think about yourself. Do you think about yourself according to what God's Word described, or you think about yourself according to what you wanted and what other people have described for you and what everybody says is good or whatever? What is it? How do you see yourself? Do you see yourself in the mirror of the Word? Do you look at yourself and see the Word being manifest, seeing Jesus be manifest? Hallelujah. Huh? Do you reach for God in the sense that you're saying, Holy Ghost, I know you're in there. I know you're walking in me and living in me. Oh, rise up, oh God. Oh, cause me to have an impact and a revelation right now. Amen. Of your inner dwelling in me. Yes. And something begins to happen. An overwhelming love, an overwhelming glory, an overwhelming strengthening power, a revelation. You go to bed at night, say, oh, Lord, I just thank you so much that tonight I'm going to lay my head on my pillow and you're going to come and you're going to speak to me. Listen, you're going to have to be careful, because if you're sitting in front of the television watching somebody get their head chopped off, yeah, you're probably going to have some kind of crazy nightmare, weirded out demonic dreams. And look, you're going to have to recognize, hold up. You're going to have a move of God in your life. You're going to have to give your thanks out to the things of the Spirit if you expect to lay down, go to bed, and have dreams of heaven and have visitations from heaven.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
But man, I think some people don't even believe in dreams and visions. Mm-hmm. Well, somebody gets dreams and visions. I don't have any. Well, you're never going to have any with an attitude like that. You ain't ever going to. It's nothing for you. You need to start imagining, wait a minute, I want dreams and visions over here. Yeah. Well, you know, Lord, bring it over here. Why? Because you poured it out according to the good pleasure of your will. You've given me the kingdom according to your own good pleasure. I don't have to talk you into this. It's something that you've already supplied. It's not something that you're going to do in the future. It's something you did in the past. It's available. It's poured out upon us by the power of the Holy Ghost. We're overwhelmed with the glory of it right now, baptized in the presence of it right now.
Yeah!
You act like it's always in the future. It's always in the future. That's not faith. It's already been done. That's faith. It's a done deal. It's faith. It's already done. It's faith. Hallelujah. It's an agreement with God's Word. It's not difficult. Oh, I wonder if God will ever do this in my life. Doubt and unbelief. Oh, I hope God will do that with me. Doubt and unbelief. What did he say he did? What did he say he would do? What did he say he's done? I mean, when you think about how God brings it down, he said he predestinated you. It's like you don't even have a choice. But you do. But it's just that radical. He's making it that impactful. He said, look, this is my determinate will that I, by my own good pleasure, you a son of God. I mean, like, come on. But there has to be an agreement with it. We got to know what it means to be a son of God. And so the only way we're going to know what that means is to go to the Word and begin to hunger for the Word and say, beloved, now are ye the sons of God, and does not yet appear what ye shall be. But when we see him, we shall see him as he is, for we shall be like him. Now everybody who has this kind of hope purifies himself, even as he's pure. And I can continue to quote the rest of the verse, but I'm going to jump to 8. And we know that the Son of God was manifested. Rather, he that sins is of the devil, for the devil sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. And when we begin to recognize, wait a minute, verse 8 is connected with verses 1 through 3, we've got a breakthrough. And God did it according to his own good pleasure. That you and I should go and destroy the works of the devil, that Christ Jesus should be manifested in our life in such a way that we destroy the works of the devil, that we understand the omnipotent power of God that lives in us. People freak out when I say this. They're going, uh-huh. And then I start quoting verses of scripture and they go, whoa. That we have been empowered to be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of His might, to take in ourselves the whole armor of God to be able to effectively deal with spiritual wickedness. That no power of Satan can touch us or harm us. We tread upon all the power of the enemy. You got to become, you have to have a mentality that you a deliverer, that you in heaven, that you belong to God, that you're carrying out His purposes. And that's something that begins to work first and foremost in our own place, in our own lives, in our own family. Because if it don't work in our life, it can't work anywhere else. If it doesn't work in our life, it cannot work outside our lives. If we do not take charge of our lives in Christ Jesus and deal with demon spirit that will oppress us, we can't deliver anybody else. We ourselves aren't going to be healed of the brokenness on the inside. You hear me?
Yes.
We can't go heal nobody else of their brokenness. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He's anointed me. You need to see that about yourself. Instead of all the poor me's and the woes me's and do I have to give up? Do I have to give up my marbles in order to have God's treasure chest? No, you can keep your marbles if you want. But you should stare a little bit more at the jewels inside that treasure chest. Just see if there's anything you like in there.
Yeah.
See. And just gaze at it a little bit more. Gaze at it a little bit more. Because I guarantee before long you're going to drop them marbles and run over there because you won't get both hands in it. You know? Because when we think about Father's good pleasure that He wants to cause us, He wants us to live in all of His fullness. And then we stop and go, we listen to the next verse. Where God tells us that He is able to do superabundantly above all that we could think or ask according to the power that already is in us, the power that is in us. A treasure chest is on the inside of us. The river of God that is placed on the inside of us. The glory of God that resides here. Christ Jesus is who is in you and me.
Yes.
And somebody said, I found no good thing in me. You got yourself a problem. You need to get saved. You need to get out of Romans chapter 7, get in Romans 8.
Amen.
Yeah. You need to quit being a child of the devil and become a son of God. Move from hallelujah. You need to quit having wickedness and evil and iniquity working in your members and start having the Holy Ghost working in your members.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You don't have to talk God into blessing you. He's trying to talk you into letting Him bless you. What we've got to grab a hold of is it's our choices. I set before you life and death, good and evil, blessings and curses. People want to just pretend that they can walk over here into the camp of the enemy, for the wages of sin is death. God should not be mocked. He that sows to the flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. And believe that we're not going to be cursed. I guarantee you, there's much proof in the Word of God from Genesis to Revelation that with sin is a curse. With disobedience is a curse, beginning in Genesis chapter 3. Well, actually, it begins in Genesis chapter 2 where God makes it known. Genesis chapter 3 is the example of it. And from there on in, we see it over and over again. God says, I said before you, heaven and hell. Do you want to live in heaven? Would you like to live in heaven tomorrow?
Yes.
And some of you, I might not even say, would you like to live in heaven tonight? You can come out of the condemnation, you can come out of the guilt, you can come out of the separation, you can come out of all the stuff, all the fear and all the intimidation, all the lust for the demonic realm. I have no desire for the demonic realm in my heart.
Amen.
I've been born of God.
Amen.
You need to have an encounter with Jesus. You got a problem? You have a problem? An encounter with Jesus will fix that problem. You've got a problem? He's here. He's here to touch you. He's here to heal you. He's here to make known to you, open up your eyes and make known to you the mystery of His will.
Amen.
So there's no mystery anymore.
Thank you.
So you can begin to see yourself as God purposed you to be. You're gonna give an account to him. He's coming. He has a lot to say about those good servants, those wise and good servants who continually watch for him, because they do not know whether he's going to come in the first watch or the second watch or the third watch. Those who aren't watching, who are diligently set with their watch, of a watchful eye on him, he's going to deliver them over to the tormentors. I'm not doing that. No. You need to go read the Gospels again. Yes. And understand what you should be doing. You read too fast last time. Yeah. This time, read for impact. Read for effect. Read for result. Read for do. Hallelujah. It's not a French word either. Read for do. Read for doing.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Your decisions are going to result in whether or not you are prepared to be a people that God has purposed to have in the midst of his sovereign movings that we call early and latter rain. Whether or not you're willing to fully represent him. There are so many people that will respond when it's too late. He says, no, you're going to sit on the sidelines. You're sitting this one out. Because when it was time to seek me, you were doing your own thing. You're coming now that the glory is here. Now you want to get right in the big middle. No. But bigger than that. Because I look at the parousias of God, or the coming, the Greek word for the coming. I look at the parousias of God in several ways. I look at it one dimension of his comings, his sovereign movings in our life. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I actually look at him at his active moving in my life, where I sit down and I fellowship with him every day. It's so easy to get download from heaven. It's so easy to continue to receive revelation, to hear him speak. You got to start talking to him first, though. You got to start getting yourself willing to participate with the Holy Ghost where you're in a place to hear. Because he's not going to talk while you're busy doing whatever it is you're doing. Are you listening to me? Running after your other interest, your other idols. Just let that sit in there for a minute.
Yes.
You turn your heart towards God. So easy to hear his voice. You got to decide, do you want to be a people prepared of the Lord? Then you got to give yourself to participating to be prepared. Because there's a shaping and there's a molding and there's a fashioning that happens as you're in the Word and as you're in prayer and as you participate with the things of the Spirit. He that sows to the Spirit of the Spirit reaps this life forevermore. I look at the parousias of God, just his comings to me, his encounters where I hear him. I'm interacting with him. I've got a set time. I've gone from a disciplined time of prayer to the call of prayer. The Lord is calling me to prayer at different times. But yet I still have a disciplined time of prayer, but yet Father still calls me to prayer. Then there's the parousia of his sovereign comings, like we read about in Hosea chapter 6, verse 3. He said, I'll come to the... He said, we'll know. Then shall we know. Then those who know the Lord shall be revealed or known because they passionately pursue him. And it's a little bit different than you would read it in King James. Because in King James it says, then shall we know those who know the Lord who follow after him. He shall come to us as the early and the latter rain. So that's the sovereign movings of God, where you read about great revivals that have taken place, like in Wales, that's taken place in the United States of America, periodically. Like on a 40-year mark, almost, as it were. We're due. Father's got something he's preparing, though. He's waiting for church. He's waiting for people. That's not going to spoil his harvest. Just think about that. Just think about the possibility of people not being impacted by the gospel because we're not willing to participate with God, not willing to go all the way with God, and for them to come in just for them to be ruined. They're just going to be in the same on the way to hell, just in a different state of on the way to hell. Instead of just a full-on right out hedonistic lost state. They're now in a religious lost state. Then there's the parousia when I die. And I don't know what hour, whether it's the first watch, second watch, or third watch. Do you know when you're going to die? Do you know when you're going to die? Everybody's got in your mind when you think you're going to die, though. And too many people are convinced that what they think is superior to what Father thinks. I don't know when I'm going to die. I'm not going to be so arrogant as to say, this is what the Lord has to do with my life. I believe that I'm going to live a very long time because I'm needed in the kingdom. Because there's not a lot of people doing what I'm doing. Speaking what I'm speaking, preaching what I'm preaching with the abandonment that I have towards Christ Jesus. Father needs laborers, and they're few as it is. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I hope there's a whole bunch of people spring up and not become redundant. Still, there's no, even when everybody springs up and becomes harvester, still Father needs more. Because it's still the situation. When you sit around thinking about why aren't you being used by God, you have to understand. It's your choices because the laborers are few. The harvest is plenteous and the laborers are few. You stop. Get unstuck. Start seeing yourself living out the Word of God. Start understanding yourself as a deliverer, someone who has the same ministry of Jesus Christ, someone whom God has purposed to reveal His Son through, someone who is right now a Son of God. And understanding the ministry of the Son of God that is anointed by the Holy Ghost to do all these things, to deliver all these people, to understand that the Son of God is manifested, was manifested, and is manifested right now in our lives to destroy the works of the devil. It's a whole new way of living. Can you hear me?
Yes.
The sacred presence of Jesus is here. He's the sacred presence of God's here. Sometimes when His presence gets so thick for me, it's like I got to almost whisper. It's the effort for me to speak louder. His glory is here. He's calling you. He's not left anybody out. You choose. You choose. I encourage you not to modify the Word of God or redefine the Word of God or try to make the Word of God fit for your own personal interests or circumstances.
Amen.
But bow before the Word. Get down on your face and bow before the Word of God, just like you bow before the living Word. Bow before His Word. Bow before His Word. Submit to His Word. Say, okay, Lord, I got it now. No more half measures. No more 75% you and 25% me. Okay, Lord, I tell you what, I make a deal with you. One for you, two for me. No, I'm going to turn that around. I'm sorry. Two for you, one for me. Begins to be all about Him. This is a glorious life. It's everything that God said it was. It's abundant life. It's everything He's described it to be. It's joy unspeakable and full of glory. It's all the blessings and all the pleasure and all the provision. He didn't exaggerate. The measure of what you have right now are the choices that you made, your willingness to cooperate. You want more?
Yes.
You need to cooperate more.
Yes.
People say, I want more of Jesus. Well, then give Him more of you. It's a trade. Because a lot of times people say, I want more of Jesus while I could retain myself in the bargain. No, it's between you. You have to decide it's going to be Him or you. And He had described to you how to live out His life. Most of everything that the Apostle Paul talks about in his writings, most of it is directed for how we're to live in the nature of Jesus Christ. How we're to walk in His love and in His humility. How we're to walk in His righteousness, His holiness, His purity. How we're to walk in His joy, in His peace. It's most all of his writing. How we to get along with each one another and love one another even as Christ loved us. But out of that, at the same time, within the community of how you do this in the nature and character of God is the explosive power and glory of God, which I believe that the stadiums of the United States of America will be filled. I believe they will be filled. I believe that there won't be any finances for football games. I'm sorry. I did watch some of the football game today. I fell so sound asleep in it, but nonetheless, it was great. But their stadiums are going to be filled with seekers. And we're either going to be filled in the Spirit of the Lord. I was talking to evangelists about this today. And we were just reminding ourselves about what God's declared He was going to do in the United States of America, how the stadiums will be filled. And I said, you know what? For me, it's not going to just be about signs and wonders. The signs and wonders are going to be there, but it's not going to just be about signs and wonders. It's that people are going to become so desperately hungry for the Word, they're going to empty out of these churches that are all about motivational speaking and hardly have any word in it. There's going to become a great need on the inside of them to hear the meat of God's word, to hear the reality of the voice of the shepherd. And that's what's going to fill the stadiums, but there's also going to be those signs and wonders and the miracles. And you've got to ask yourself, are you willing to be prepared unto every good work? And you've got to understand that there's a price to pay. God has done it of His own good pleasure. He's given it to us all. He's made it all available. But you and I are going to have to choose whether or not we want His change. We're going to have to choose whether or not we want His ways, or whether we want all the good pleasures that He gives, which puts us in an entirely different way and dimension of living. We're going to have to be willing to step up and go, wait a minute. I want to be counted worthy.
Yeah.
Wait a minute. Father, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. What? I just read 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 7. What? What? Counted worthy? Lord, what do I got to do to be counted worthy? And then somebody comes to the pastor and says, what do I got to do to be counted worthy? Well, read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and you'll hear Jesus tell you over and again what you have to do. Because that's so many sermons right there. That's so many messages. He tells us very clearly. He tells us very clearly. Over and again. Over and again. It's the biggest part of Jesus' message. Over and again. We miss it. Don't miss it anymore. You will not miss it anymore. I have something that's far greater in effect than a magic wand. You will not miss it anymore. Your eyes will be open. You'll see. I'm a deliverer. I have the ministry of Jesus. In other words, Jesus came to set the captives free. He sent me to go set the captives free. To break the oppression off of those who are bound by demonic power and sickness and disease, to destroy every work of the devil. People, when you begin to see who you are and you've got a purpose and a reason for living, all of a sudden the heavenly realm and the heavenly vision and the heavenly glory, come on. You know, the Lord made it so radical. He like put salvation on our shoulders. When He showed Paul what the heavenly vision was, He said, I give you power to turn him from Satan to God. It's like, it's you. So there's got to be somebody who steps over into the realm, no longer participating with the realms of iniquity, who have authority, you know? It's like the devil comes to the sons of Sceva. Hey, look, Jesus I know and Paul I know, but I know who you are, and right now you can get, I'm going to beat the snot out of you.
Yes.
And that's what happened.
That's what happened.
Huh? The man jumped on him and just thrashed him to death. All seven of them, or however many there were. You know what I'm saying? Come on. He gave me the power. You see, He showed me that He had given me the authority. He made me a deliverer, like the deliverers and the judges. Yeah, He made me a deliverer. Think about it. To turn him from darkness to light.
Woo.
Yeah.
From the power of Satan to God. That's delivering them out of the hands. You talk about getting delivered out of the hands of the Philistines or the Amorites or the Midianites. Get delivered out of the camp of the powers of darkness, out of the jaws of hell.
Amen.
You're talking about getting set free from a prison. So God's made us to be. We need to start thinking it, breathing it, imagining it, living it, getting prepared for it. To understand what it means that what we're responsible to do, what it means to walk worthy. I pray that God counts you worthy.
Amen.
Fulfill all the good pleasure of His goodness. Oh. With the work of faith and power. I want to be counted worthy. I'm going to be watching. I'm going to be waiting on my master. I'm going to be rendering to my master his due service. Hallelujah. My heart's going to be fixed. It's going to be set on Him. I'm going to put my hand to the plow and look back. I'm not going to think about what I wear while I eat. I'm not going to think about my own issues and my own needs. I'm going to seek first the kingdom, His righteousness. I'm going to do those things that Jesus said. I'm going to bless those who curse me that I might inherit a blessing. I'm going to love those who despitefully use me and hate me, say all manner of evil against me falsely. I'm going to lay down my life for the brethren. I'm going to do what He told me to do so that I may be found there completely under His sovereign rule. Not doing my will, doing what He wants. Well, Lord, I don't want to love them. Then do good, do your own thing. But what I'm going to tell you, you want to walk with me, you love them. And you get to still loving them right now. And you try to make all excuses why you shouldn't have to. And then Father's not listening anymore. He doesn't engage in that. I'm going to tell you right now, He doesn't engage in it. He ain't going to argue with you. He's not going to listen to you. He's not going to do it. It's unrighteousness. It's stubbornness. He won't participate. He won't. I know, because I walk with the Holy Ghost enough to recognize what grieves Him, where He stops speaking. I want you to walk with Him close enough to where you know what grieves Him and how He stops speaking so that you don't do the same thing.
Yes.
Go to prayer. Give yourself to the Word. His Word will shape you. His Word will mold you.
Yes.
His Word will cause you to be conformed to the image of Christ Jesus. You've been predestinated. Think about these words. Predestinated to be conformed to the image of Christ, that He may be the first fruits among many brethren. Romans 8:29. Think about that. Huh? Predestinated you to be sons according to the good pleasure of His will. I know some people's Bibles read predestinated to the adoption of children. It doesn't even say that. It's predestinated to sonship. That's what it literally says, predestinated to sonship. Hallelujah. And we know what sonship is defined in Galatians chapter 4. You need to see that about yourself. And when you do, that's exactly what you're going to be feeling. You're going to be feeling that right there. And you're going to be just enjoying His presence. And it isn't in all these other things that God speaks. He speaks in the midst of us enjoying His presence. Many times people got to start praying in the Holy Ghost to get out of whatever they're being oppressed by, to get over into now being out of the oppression, so now that they're now open to receive the pleasure of His presence. Huh? The rivers of His pleasure. But then you'll come into a place in your life and your walk with God where you won't allow the oppression to work, and you'll just live in the goodness of His presence. You just live in the joy of His presence. Hallelujah. Then you're a joy to be around. Hallelujah. Then you're just in love with everybody. You don't have a bad word to say about any that body. That guile and iniquity is not working in you. Because when the guile and iniquity is working in you and you're speaking bad things, either about God or about somebody else or complaining or murmuring, God's not there. You shut Him down. He's not there. He's not open to the rivers of His pleasure. He's not there. Somebody says, well, He never leave me and forsake me. He walked away. He shut down. I guarantee you. He's not living in your life. He's now living under the word of a curse. You're living in a curse. You're cursing yourself. You're living under the oppression of doubt and unbelief. You're living under the authority of another word, a lie. A lie will bring you into bondage. The truth will set you free. You believe a lie and you'll be damned immediately. And if you continue to lie eternally, the truth comes to liberate you. The Holy Ghost has come. Father's dedicated to this. He's given us the word of truth. He gave us Jesus truth personified. He gave us the word of truth. And He gave us the spirit of truth. Whew. So that we can live out the truth. Live in the reality of what God's purpose, no longer be deceived, no longer be sidetracked and shut down. His word is a lamp unto our feet, is a light in our path that shows us where to set every step. It shows us to where every action is supposed to look like, where every action is supposed to be, so that all of our deeds and all of our doings are wrought in God, produced by God, that our whole expression out of our life is a fruit, an expression, a revelation of the Holy Ghost. Just dedicated to it. giving all diligence to making your calling and election sure, is continually watching for your Lord, for you do not know when he's going to come. It is a place of being prepared in him. It is a place of like, oh God, count me worthy. Count me worthy. Count me worthy, oh God. I love your presence. I love it. And Father sees, you know, he's got something going on far beyond just what you say in church. He saw you Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday.
Amen.
And it has a lot of bearing on what how he responds to you on Sunday. Yes. And I pray that you grow, I pray that you assemble yourselves all the more together as you see the day approaching. I pray that every church service is important to you. Every meeting is important to you. In Jesus' name. Everybody stand with me.